विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुः साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। सो वी आर टुवर्ड्स द कंक्लूजन और ऑफ द सेकेंड चैप्टर श्री गुरु स्तवन ग्लोरी ऑफ द गुरु एंड ज्ञानेश्वर महाराज सेज I salute the most auspicious feet of the Sadguru, he who is glorified as Nivrittinatha. How? By dissolving my individuality in his grace. So we have to vanish. As long as we are there, till we have not vanished. It is the seeker or the disciple who discovers the Guru within himself. You have a desire for food. And where is the food? Outside. Unless that food doesn't become one with you, till then the desire for food doesn't go away. Exactly the same way. Until and unless that guru who is outside, until and unless that guru, that scripture, that God, that idea, until and unless it doesn't become one with you, the desire for it will not go away. Take this point. And once the hunger is, once the food becomes one with you, then the desire for food is not there at all. So, seeing the Guru outside, keep praising the Guru outside and becoming body oriented with respect to the Guru Maharaj is not the way of the spiritual seekers, is not the way of the disciple. It begins that way, but it must culminate in no desire for the Guru Tattva, no desire for realization. Understand this, it must culminate in that. So our contemplation, our deliberation must be in this manner that it leads to no desire. See, then we are true disciples of the Guru Tattva, of the Guru Maharaj. Now, in the 80th verse, thus Sant Jnaneshwara introduces the next chapter in this concluding OV. Ata Jnana Deva Mhane Shri Guru Praname Yene Phedili Vacharune Chauhi Vachachi. Jnanadeva says, in this way, the debt of all the four speeches are duly paid by offering salutations to Sri Nivrittinatha Guru Maharaj. And what are these four speeches? Debt of four speeches? The Vaikari Madhyama Pashyati Para. What are they? The gross, subtle, causal and transcendental. The gross is covering the subtle, subtle is covering the causal, causal is covering the transcendental. See? just like the mist is covering the waves, the wave is covering the ocean, ocean is covering the waters. So these are expressions of the divine only in their essence, but the speeches, they appear only at the matter level, only at the matter. In this way, Jnandeva says, the Guru Maharaj has been saluted, and by these salutations, the limitation of the four speeches has been transcended. So once we have merged, once we have recognized, once we have discovered the Guru Tattva, then there is no one to say, I have discovered the Guru Tattva. No. Then that's your natural state. Why was the thought required? Why was the speech required? Why did you need to listen to these words? Only because we are not established. And after being established, will speaking go on? Yes, it will go on. But you have to determine where you are at this moment. So speech is activity, kriya. Kriya is there only for one purpose. Kriya cannot make you realize. Kriya, activity, cannot make you realize. Truth is beyond the activity. But we don't know how to be without activity. So here Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying that by these salutations, the limitations of the four speeches has been transcended. By which salutations? The till 79th verse, all the explanation that was being given, was it given in silence? Or was it given by way of speech? He was speaking, no? Or he was writing, and or if he was speaking, whatever that time happened. But all that he wrote or spoke, the thoughts must have appeared in his mind. That's why these words are there, isn't it? So Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, by uttering these 79 verses, 79 OVs, the debt of the four speeches has been transcended, because the speech was employed in such a manner that he reached his essence, he abided in his essence. In the spiritual sadhana called the path of knowledge, importance is given to Shakti Upasana. Shakti expresses in us in the forms of four speeches or vanis. If you remember when we introduced this text there, it was told Shakti, the power, the Alhadini Shakti, or here Shiva Shakti, the Shakti, she expresses as three. What are they? She expresses as the Jnana Shakti, Kriya Shakti, and Ichha Shakti. Again, Sattva Rajas Tamas. Jnana Shakti, Kriya Shakti, and Ichha Shakti. Jnana Shakti is the Sattva, Ichha Shakti is the Rajas, एंड क्रिया शक्ति इज द तमस इन दैट सेंस. सो हियर व्हेन ही सेज दैट शक्ति एक्सप्रेसेस इन अस इन द फॉर्म ऑफ फोर स्पीचेस, अगेन दैट स्पीच ऑल्सो कैन बी डिवाइडेड इन टू सत्व रजस तमस एंड ट्रांसेंडेंटल. द ग्रॉस स्पीच इज द तमसिक, द मध्यमावाणी और द सटल स्पीच इज द रजसिक, देन पश्यंती वाणी और द कॉजल स्पीच इज सात्विक, एंड बियॉन्ड दैट द परावाणी दैट इज द ट्रांसेंडेंटल. Because remember, these three modes of sattva, rajas, tamas are pervading everything. Now, Swamiji says, the grossest, now again, now Swamiji is explaining the gross, subtle, causal and transcendental. The Vaikhari Vani, speech in Maharashtra, in Sanskrit also, Vani. Vani means speech. So Vaikhari is the gross speech, Vaikhari Vani is the gross speech, Madhyama Vani is the subtle speech, Pashyanti Vani is the causal speech, and Paravani is the transcendental speech. So the first one, gross speech. The grossest is the Vaikhari Vani located in the organ of speech, such as tongue, etc. The speech that comes out of the Vaikhari or body, here, the sound, nama, and the object, rupa, referred to are separate. So what is the quality of this Vaikhari Vani? First is, it comes out of the mouth and the tongue. And the other quality is, the name is on the tongue and the form is outside the tongue. The name, laptop, is in the word on in the mouth, but the object which represents this laptop, that is other than the tongue. See, so the separation, the name is within and the form is without, and so both they are separate. So this is the position of the Vaikhari Vani. The world, Srishti, the word Srishti is in the mouth, but the expanse of the world is outside the mouth. The word food is in the mouth, but it is there in the kitchen, you have to go there. Next comes the Madhyamavani, located in the throat, the Adam's apple. Many times when we are doing japa, when Vaikhari has been transcended, when do you transcend the Vaikhari? Two ways. Either you have gone beyond the Vaikhari in the contemplation, or you are tired of Vaikhari, of speaking. And the japa goes on, the Adam's apple is moving up and down. Going on. Madhyama, so the position of Madhyavani is the throat. The position of Vaikhari Vani is in the tongue. It illuminates the waking state. It talks about the waking state. The position of the waking world is in the Vaikhari. The position of the dream world is in the Madhyama. So Vaikhari purifies the waking world. Madhyama purifies the subtle world or the dream world. And you cannot force yourself, no, I'm going to go bypass the the gross world, I'm going to bypass the subtle world, the dream world, I'll go straight away to the transcendental. Not possible. You cannot say, I'm going to bypass all the ears and straight away become a father. No, you have to go through all the years one after the other. Only then you will become grown up and become a husband, then a father. See, you cannot bypass. You cannot say that I'm going to, how many chapatis you, dosas you eat? I eat five dosas when I sit down. Oh, so why should I do hard work of eating five dosas? Why don't I eat the fifth dosa first? Then I'll be full. It doesn't work that way. You have to go through one, two, three, four. And Amma has to make it fresh, fresh. So same way. We have to, every time we sit down, we have to go through the Vaikhari, then the Madhyama, then the Pashyanti, then the Para. It must pull us in. Just like sleep pulls us in, just like we pull the food in to satiate the hunger. So if our attention is on the divine, then the speech, the gross speech will be pulled into Madhyama speech, subtle speech. The Madhyama will be pulled into the causal speech. The causal will be pulled into the transcendental speech. So next comes the Madhyamavani, located in the throat, where the name and form are not separated. Just like in the dream, the name of the object is in the mind and the form of the object is also in the mind. It is not outside the mind. And thus the name and form are not separated. The Nama Roop, name and form, or Vachya Vachaka Bheda, difference, is accepted but not established. Establishment, specificity happens in the waking state, in the gross. In the subtle, it's all a minestrone soup, all in the mind only, all floating around. Then the third one is the Pashyanti Vani, is located above the nabhi in the Manipura Chakra. Here, the Nama Roop Bhed is not accepted. So, some places they say the heart, some places they say just one, how many? Two fingers above the nabhi. And when you come to this point, you will feel a slight pull. When that gets activated, you will feel a slight pull. You will feel a throb. You will feel a slight pinprick sort of a feeling is there. Here the Nama Roop Bheda is not accepted. So what happens in the Pashyanti Vani? The manifest name and form, first it was gross manifest in the waking, in the Vaikhari. In the subtle or the dream or the Madhyamavani, it was subtle manifest. In the gross it was separate, in the subtle, in the Madhyama, they are not separated, they have not become specific, but they are still subtle manifest. In Vaikhari it was gross manifest, in Madhyama it is subtle manifest, in Pashyanti it is unmanifest. It is unmanifest, just like in a seed. What is a seed? In which the root, the shoot, the tree, branches, the leaves, the flowers, everything is unmanifest. Potential is there. Potential is there. And we are not talking about a dry seed, we are talking about a living seed. So that is the Pashyanti Vani. And Para, in the Para Vani, located in Mooladhara Chakra, at the base of the spinal column, the Vani is in unmanifest state. Swamiji is saying here, unmanifest, better would be transcendental state. So how he has divided it is, in the Pashyanti, the name and form is not accepted, it's not expressing. And he's taking the Paravani as the unmanifest state, which takes you to Avyakta. In the Paravani, the differentiation has not yet begun out of, but the potentiality is as if it is ready to start. So what will be this point of Paravani? Paravani will be, if you take a dry seed and you put, give it sunshine and water, that first, before that moment, the moment life enters, but the possibilities have not become available yet. They are not, the activity within the unmanifest, within the Pashyanti or within the seed have not become possible. Just that one moment before. This bulb is there. You switch it on, the light comes, isn't it? What is that point where the electricity becomes light? What is that one point where the electricity becomes the heat? See, that point is the para. It is ready to start. And what is Pashyanti? Where the possibilities are all available, but they have not become subtle or gross manifest. See? It's like that fruit. Before the fruit comes, what is there? There is a flower. So when does the flower turn into the fruit? In the fruit, if you open it, so many seeds are there. Even in passion fruit, so many seeds are inside there. Each seed has the possibility of becoming a tree. But when did that fruit come about? So when you look at the flower, you know that the fruit is going to come. But it has not happened yet. You're looking at the flower. And then when the fruit comes, then what happens? In that fruit, all the possible seeds are in the unmanifest form. You can't see the seeds. They are all inside. And then that seed, if planted, will become another tree. See, same way. It is ready to start. In Pashyanti Vani, the potentiality is ready to manifest. So first, the first part at the Paravani was that the differentiation has not yet begun, but it is about to start. In Pashyanti Vani, the differences are ready to manifest. In the first one, it was ready to start. In the second one, they are ready to manifest. In the Madhyamavani, the potentiality has manifested, but the manifestation has not become gross enough to result in the differences between the thought and the object of thought. In the Vaikari Vani, this differentiation has taken place. Para, Pashyanti, in the order of grossification. Para, Pashyanti, Madhyama, Vaikari. Vaikari is the grossest. In this way, when I have saluted the Guru Maharaj, I have transcended the four speeches. At the Vaikari level, the meaning of Guru and the object called Guru were separate. See how beautifully Swamiji is telling. At the Vaikari level, what was the Vaikari level? The name and the form are separate. The Guru word is in my mouth. Guru Maharaj ki jai, the Guru word is in my mouth. And the word person representing the Guru, he is outside. So, at the Vaikari level, the meaning of the Guru and the object, the name and the form, they are separate. Then, at the Madhyamavani, by constant remembrance of the Guru, one realizes that the Guru is not someone far away, but that he is all the time with oneself. Then our attention gets weaned away from the form. You can try this out. You can look at a flame, a lamp. Keep looking at it without blinking for some time. Or the sun. Keep looking at it. Or any, even the picture of the Lord in your altar. But look at it without blinking. You should not get a headache. This is called tratak. Keep looking, and after some time, if you close your eyes, the same flame or the sun or the image of the Lord, you will see it in your mind. Before it was separate to you, now it is inside of you. See? So, from Vaikari to Madhyama, from gross to subtle, you are still seeing the form.
Alert from calendar, Queen's birthday, Queensland. Alert from calendar, Labor Day, regional holiday.
So in this way, more evolved than this is the Pashyanti level, where one feels, I am the one who is remembering the Guru, and I am also the Guru. Because the difference between I and the Guru is no longer there. See? The difference is not there. And naturally, one will come to. This is what we are telling today in the meditation, that our notion that we are, that the world is, that we are in the world, that the body is in, the mind is inside the body. And when we hear these words, yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasa sah, that the mind cannot comprehend, the mind cannot realize the truth, we feel the truth is somewhere deep inside, which the mind cannot access. But exactly the opposite is true. Everything is in the self as the self. The Vaikari can never come to know the source. But it is the source alone expressing as the Para, Pashyanti, Madhyama and Vaikari. The husband can never come to know the man. Husband has to vanish for the man to express. Because husband doesn't exist in the first place. Same way, more evolved than this is the Pashyanti, where one feels, I am the one who is remembering the Guru and I am also the Guru. Meaning now you are taking full responsibility. This started in the Madhyama. And it leads to this point of that who is more important? If I am remembering this, why am I running after someone? If the scriptures are telling me that I am the source, if the Guru Maharaj is telling you are already that which you are seeking, then why am I running after a personality, a specific personality? Personality is always specific anyway. Why am I obsessed with Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj? It must be done. Initially it must be all done, because that's how everyone begins. When you are very body oriented, it must be done. Because we want to purify. And for purification, some altar is required, and there you do nishkama seva, you serve without any desire, then purification happens. And this is what is told in the Vedas also. If the rituals are done in the correct manner, then automatically the upasana begins. If your attention is on the divinity and you do the seva, then automatically manasik puja will begin or upasana will begin. The manas puja will then move to the upasana. Upasana is remembering the divine. Now you don't want to do the 16 step puja. You just want to chant the name of the Lord. That is more potent than the 16 step puja. Why should I break the speech, break the thoughts into so many different varieties? I'll just hold on to one. Om or Om Namah Shivaya, whatever your deity is. But your attention should not be only on that. Your attention is, I want to merge into the deity. That is your blessings. That is the grace. And while taking the name of the Lord, you go into Savikalpa Samadhi, and eventually it leads to Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So you are transcending. Where did you start? From the outside. Where did you end up? Within yourself. See? Do not... Someone called me the other day. One neurologist, and he met some masters and this and that. He said, I spent some time with this person, I spent time with that person, it was so wonderful, it was so divine. Only one thought came to me at that time, what he wanted to tell was over. I said, don't outsource the realization. Don't outsource it. Don't become dependent on the Guru Maharaj. Yes, we need his grace, but don't become dependent. Don't become dependent on the scriptures. Don't become dependent on the God outside in the temples. You have to realize it within. When he is saying in Bhagavad Gita again and again that I created the creation and I entered the creation and I am expressing through every being as his Atma, then where is the question? That means we are going wrong in our approach somewhere. At the Paravani level, even the differentiation is at the Pashyanti level, where one feels, I am the one who is remembering the guru, and I am also the guru. So here now obsession with the Guru Maharaj as a person is overcome. Now we are coming to the point. What is the point? Who is more important? If Guru Tattva is the Atma Tattva, then why should I keep thinking of the Guru as separate? And who is giving importance to the Guru as Guru? The I. So what is more important? I. That I alone is taking the position, forgetting the original I and taking the position of the disciple. The moment he takes the position of the disciple, Guru Maharaj also appears simultaneously. So now he is coming, going back to the one which expresses as the Guru and Shishya. Just like Paramashiva alone expresses as Shiva and Shakti. Paramashiva alone expresses as the Guru and Shishya. See, understand the whole picture. We are lost in the specifics. Look at the principles. These are the principles. And in this way, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, I have transcended the four speeches. What is the debt? The runa. Runa means debt. We pay to the four speeches. When the seeker gets established in the Madhyama Vani, he has paid his debt to the Vaikhari Vani. He has gone beyond its clutches. What is Vaikhari? Where specificity is the norm. Separation, differentiation is the norm. I versus you is the norm. So when we have transcended this differentiation, then we have paid the debt to the Vaikhari Vani. We have paid the debt to the waking world. We have paid the debt to the gross speech. So now with this understanding, then use your speech so that you can transcend your speech. Not to eat someone's head. Not to give lectures. If you want to give lectures, why we are doing these lectures? I keep saying it so many times. One day it will go away. If it is meant to, it will go away one day. And is this not what you are doing every day? You start in the morning in silence. When you get up, you are still in bed, you are in silence. And then the speaking begins, the thoughts convert into speech. Whole day, because you are obsessed with the speech, so it goes on and on and on and on. And then when the night comes, again, the gross speech is absorbed into the subtle speech. The subtle speech, which we call as dream, and then the dream is also absorbed into the unmanifest speech, which we call as the sleep. But we miss the fourth one, which is the transcendental. For that you have to be aware. For that you have to be awake. For that you have to be alert. But unknowingly, same is happening. That's the default. But we are remaining ignorant in that default mode. When we do it consciously, then the debt is paid. Then the debt is paid. This is a recognition. When the seeker gets established in the Madhyama Vani, he has paid his debt to the Vaikhari Vani, means now no longer he is persecuted by the variety, the multitude of the world. What is there in the gross world? हीट, कोल्ड, कंफर्ट, डिसकंफर्ट, हंगर, थर्स्ट, लाइक्स, डिसलाइक्स, प्रेज, इंसल्ट, ऑल दिस इज परसिक्यूशन बाय द ग्रॉस वर्ल्ड ऑन द इंडिविजुअल. नाउ दिस सीकर, ही हैज बिकम इम्यून टू ऑल दैट. व्हाई? ही इज विद इन हिमसेल्फ. He has interacted in the right manner with the world. He did not go there to improve the world. He did not go there to reorganize the world. He did not go there for the security of the world. Then I will do my sadhana. No. He interacted with the world in such a manner that he reached Madhyama consciously. Because unconsciously you will go into dream. We are going consciously. Then we have paid the debt to the Vaikhari. At the Madhyama level, Vani level, by constant contemplation on the divine, the thought of the pure consciousness or the Guru is never lost. So such people, you must have all come across masters, grihasthas, who are so in tune with the divine name that anything you say, Hari Om or Ram Ram or Jai Shri Krishna, if someone comes and asks a question, they will answer. The moment the answer is done, again they are back to their mantra. I mean, they are not interested in this world. But if someone comes, yes, they will respond. That response is invoked out of the person. Who is giving the response? The mind only is giving the response. Their attention while giving the response is where? It's still on the divine theme. See? Where is your attention when you are performing your actions? Depends where you are. If you think you are the father, you have to take care of the family, you are the only bread earner of the family, then all your activities are being guided. Your focus in the back of your mind is the family. The seeker's attention, where is the seeker's attention? On the consciousness, on the divine theme. So choose wisely if you are a seeker. Don't allow your mind to get corrupted. Don't react to the world. So when we have come to Madhyama, our reaction to the Vaikhari, meaning the gross world, ceases. It may happen in one go or it may happen slowly. Up to the, it will depend upon how deeply we are involved in the Madhyama. If it is only for 5-10 minutes, okay, it's a beginning. Then as we keep practicing, then 24/7 we are in that Madhyama. Even in deep sleep the mantra is going on. The moment you wake up, the mantra becomes manifest. You go to sleep with the mantra, you wake up with the mantra. That is Madhyama. At Madhyama Vani level, by constant contemplation on the divine, the thought of the pure consciousness or the Guru is never lost. We are continuously aware of the Atmik Tattva, the Divine Tattva, or the Guru Tattva. In Vaikhari, we get lost. Right now, here we are with the Amrit Anubhav. After the satsang is over, then the attention will go on to the dosa, it will go on to the idli, then it will go on to what you have to do, that you have to weed the garden, or you have to plant, water the plants, etc., etc., etc. Is there, you have to find a way. Is there a way that all this happens and yet we do not forget the Guru Tattva or the divine theme, which is the basis of life itself? We have to explore that. And that we will come closer to it if we have this understanding within us that whatever we do in the waking, whatever we do at the Vaikhari level, is only for purification purpose, is only to move to the Madhyama. It is not to prove anything in this world. It is not for, Vaikhari is not used to prove anything in this world. Vaikhari is not used to judge anything. Vaikhari is not used to argue with anyone. Vaikhari is not used to establish the truth of the gross world. See, these are the wrong notions with which we live by. Then what are we using Vaikhari Vani, the gross speech, for? Only to purify so that we can come and abide in the Madhyama. And as we come into the Madhyama, then this erratic attention on the divine theme in the waking, which happens in the morning, in the evening, when you light the lamp, or when you are studying the scriptures, or when you come to the satsang, you don't spend the whole day thinking about the divine theme in the waking. But when we come to the Madhyama, automatically, for whatever period we are in the Madhyama or in the subtle, if we have come there as a result of withdrawal, as a result of purification, then the divine theme will be continuous in our mind. And what is that? In the Madhyama, the name and the form are one, are both thoughts. In the waking, the name was, God's name was in my mouth and the form was outside. But in Madhyama, the name of the God is in my mind and the form is also in my mind. गाड़ी चल रही है. एंड ही इज ऑलवेज विद मी, एफर्टलेस, अनइन्वॉल्व. सो वेन आवर अटेंशन ऑन द गुरु और द डिवाइन इज कंटिन्यूअसली एट द इन द माइ इन द सटल और इन द मध्यमा, देन देर इज अ कंप्लीट सेंस ऑफ फियरलेसनेस, बिकॉज यू नेवर फील that you are separate from the divinity. You feel you are protected, taken care of by the guru or the divine all the time, because you are not seeing the separate, you know that he is there. Now you don't have to go to a temple to interact with him. You don't have to go to the scripture to interact with him. You don't have to go to the person, the Guru Maharaj, in order to be in his presence and feel the blessings and auspiciousness. Now that outward, what was being experienced is experienced within the mind. This is the growth. This is the growth. See? That he is always with me, effortless and uninvolved. See, then this in Madhyama, as we keep going, a point will come where you will realize that whether you are making the effort to mentally chant the mantra or remember the guru or not, he is always there. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. I made the effort just now. I remembered and chanted. But when we are in Madhyama, the mantra is going on. Involuntarily it is coming. see. Because our problem is we want security. That's why we are doing all the hard work in the outside world to make ourselves secure. And when will we feel secure? When we have $1 million, $2 million, $10 million? Even that will not give you security. How many houses? It will not give you security. Because somewhere deep inside our heart, we know the true security is the Lord. Yoga kshemam vahamyaham, Bhagwan says. So where we are taking refuge? In money, in investments, in keep doing that, no problem. But don't give value to it so much. The true refuge, true security is the divine. And not divine as a concept. Not divine as a concept. Divine as being. Divine as not a separate entity from ourselves. But divinity as our own essential nature. But to get to that, this is the interim step. Madhyama is the interim step. So we have weaned ourselves away from the gross and we have not merged into the self yet. This is the in-between. Where the divine has taken over our mind, we feel fully secure and protected and taken care of. This is where the intuitiveness becomes, as we practice, your intuitive ability will increase. Things will start falling in place. See? He is always with me, effortless, uninvolved. So that, and what is the ultimate, as we keep moving in this Madhyama, we realize the mantra is going on and I am observing the mantra, this disposition comes about. That mantra is going on involuntarily in the mind. And you are watching. I am not making any efforts to chant the mantra. But it's going on. And once it has to click, oh, so mantra is not the guru. The one who is watching the mantra is the Atma. The one who is noticing, observing the mantra which is happening at the mind level, at the thought level, the one, the observer is the Guru Tattva. The observer is in its essence the divine tattva. And you come this at this moment, it may not come in the vaikhari, it comes as if I am body all the time. But in the subtle madhyama, it comes to this position that whether the mantra is there or not there, I am always there. Because mantra is limited, it begins Om, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Then there is silence. Then again Om, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Again silence. But I am continuous. Mantra is intermittent. I am continuous. And this by grace of God, by grace of the Guru, the seeker, the disciple comes to realize this. That I am the continuous principle. And how did he get there? By holding on to the name, by holding on to the japa, by holding on to the utilizing his vaikhari to move to madhyama, and now utilizing the madhyama in order to transcend the madhyama also and go to paschanti and on. See? So, how, वी हैव टू बी क्लियर वॉट अवर जर्नी इज, अदरवाइज जब कल लगे हुए हैं डूइंग, अच्छा खाना बन गया क्या, चाय बन गई क्या, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे हरे, अरे डोसा अभी तक नहीं आया यार, ऐसे नहीं होता। देन वी आर शॉर्ट चेंजिंग अवर सेल्स बाय सच कॉन्टम्पलेशन। वंस इंडिविजुअलिटी स्लोली लूजेज इट्स होल्ड ऑन वन एंड वन इज एज इफ एब्जॉर्ब्ड इन द गुरु, दस वन कम्स टू द पश्यंती लेवल आफ्टर हैविंग पेड द डेट टू मध्यमा वाणी। दिस इज एग्जैक्टली वॉट आई वॉज सेइंग, स्लोली 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 इट विल हैपन, बट वी हैव टू कमिट एंड वी हैव टू बी सिंसियर एंड वी मस्ट नो दैट द गोल इज नॉट टू इस्टैब्लिश द वर्ल्ड, द गोल इज टू रियलाइज डिस्कवर रिकॉग्नाइज द ट्रांसेंडेंटल स्पिरिट विच इज अवर एसेंशियल नेचर एंड दैट स्पिरिट दैट आत्मतत्व दैट गुरु तत्व इज ऑल इंक्लूसिव, इट्स इंक्लूसिव ऑफ पश्यंती परा पश्यंती मध्यमा एंड वैखरी, इट इज इंक्लूसिव ऑफ द एंटायर वेकिंग ड्रीम डीप स्लीप समाधि, इट्स इंक्लूसिव प्रिंसिपल, इट इज नॉट द ट्रूथ वर्सेस द वर्ल्ड, इट इज नॉट लाइक दैट। By such contemplation, one's individuality slowly loses its hold on one, and one is as if absorbed in the Guru. Now, what is happening? As we move from Vaikari to Madhyama, the impact of the world of differences is reduced. And when we are in Madhyama, and there the name and form are one, but there now, if you are holding on to the name of the Lord, the number of thoughts disturbing you are less, it's only one mantra. And if you are doing that with devotion, it will end up in you being the observer of the mantra, or you people have visions of gods and all that things happens at this level, savikalpa samadhi. So coming to this level is paying the debt to Madhyamavani, where we become completely clear as regards the Guru Tattva or the Divine Tattva. We don't feel that we are separate to it. Because see, separation was in Vaikari. Separation is not in the Madhyama. In this way, step by step, the seeker transcends the four speeches. This is how the Guru Maharaj has been saluted by Sant Jnaneshwara. This last OV thus becomes the theme of the next chapter. The next chapter deals with the transcending of the four speeches, how it is done and the nature of the sadhana involved. Oh, what more can we talk? There will be a lot more to talk. This is just a preview, a trailer of the next chapter. Throughout Amrut Anubhav, Jnaneshwar Maharaj emphasizes first the need for changing our vision. First step. Second, the readiness to change the vision. See, one is the desire to change the vision, and the other is the readiness to change the vision. Okay, first is the need, then second is the readiness, and the third is the ability to change the vision, and the fourth is the resolve to bargain for total loss in gaining this vision. Our problem is we want to change the vision, we want to be, and therefore we come onto this spiritual path, but we want to hold on to everything in this world. And that too only in the gross world, not in the dream and deep sleep. We want to hold on to everything in the gross world. But if we want to develop this divine vision, this divine vision only comes about by tyage naike amritatva manashuhu. Only when we lose everything, then alone this vision is inaugurated within us. The freshness, rejuvenation of the mind comes about by total loss of waking and dream. Until unless you are not even available, even an iota, to the waking and dream experience, till then rejuvenation, recharging of you will not happen. And this is your experience every night, isn't it? In the total loss is the rejuvenation, recharging. Now it is happening involuntarily to us on a daily basis. Here we are bringing it about consciously. And once it happens consciously, then you are permanently recharged. No more intermittent recharging. There is no flat battery after that. Such are Mahatmas. Ever inspired, their presence itself is auspicious. So first is the need. So that need, that I need to change my vision, my approach to the world, my approach to my possessions, my approach to my relations, my approach to my past, my approach to my future, my approach to my default positions, my approach to time, space and objectivity. There is something wrong because it is not giving me the satisfaction, contentment, transcendence which I am seeking. So I need to interact with all these in a different way. Whatever mindset, convictions I have created with regards to all this, I need to change them. This is the first one. Unless you don't feel the need, till then you will not make the effort that is required. Once the need is felt, just wishing it will not help. Then you have to be ready to do whatever is required to be done. I am ready to give exam, but I will not prepare for the exam. You will never pass the exam. I am ready to be a surgeon, but I don't like this, I don't like that, I don't like cutting, I don't like hospitals, I don't like the smell in the hospitals. You will never be a surgeon then. So first is readiness. The second is ability. Then you develop yourself in such a manner, and the inspiration to perform in that, to become able, comes from the need and readiness. We have to keep firing the need. That, and what is the need for us? That we are essentially divine. That is our natural state. Yes, I am ready to know myself as that I am divine. Now you have to do what is required to be done. Just saying I am ready is not enough. You have to do the hard yaka. You have to do the japa, you have to do the puja, you have to do the yoga, you have to do the whatever. Naturally, you are inspired by. Do that. And there are many things. Here it is simple. Vaikari madhyama pashyanti para. Take the Lord's name. Then, but you have to do it. I am ready to do it. I am waiting for a guru to initiate me. Whole life will go away in waiting. Start. And what is that guru going to do? Your goal is to realize yourself. What is the guru going to do? The guru will come into your life only if you begin. But you want to choose a guru who listens to you, who gives you the mantra that you want. Nobody initiated me. I took my mantra. It came from within. I chanted with the mantra. Result of that was a Guru Maharaj came into my life. See? So the ability to change the vision and our efforts, ability will be the efforts. Readiness is your conviction that I must change the vision. Readiness is the readiness leads to the application, the efforts, and your efforts must be put in such a manner that they lead to effortlessness. Efforts should not be put that it make you put more efforts afterwards. When you wake up today, you are going to put efforts throughout the day only to give up efforts and go into the lap of sleep. So in the sadhana also, our efforts should be in such a manner that they become lead to effortlessness. So when we come from vaikhari to madhyama, we are moving from effort to effortlessness. And when we get into Pashyanti, complete effortlessness, because the name and the form both become unmanifest. There is silence, yet you are awake, yet you are conscious. So what is the total loss in Pashyanti? The Pashyanti, the total loss is of the name and form. In Pashyanti, the total loss is of Vaikhari and Madhyama. See, how wonderful. So the fourth point is the resolve to bargain for total loss in gaining this vision. And in this manner, this is what Jnaneshwar Maharaj is emphasizing. The need, the readiness, the ability, and the resolve. The Guru Maharaj will strip the disciple of all the three planes of consciousness. All happenings will end. Happenings are illusions. Happenings are phenomena. Happenings are existing in their own absence. It's mithya. And we have to accept. If we are a seeker, we have to accept that this waking, dream, and deep sleep are only a phenomena. There, and we have taken the waking to be so real and becoming miserable on account of that. We don't become miserable because of sleep. We don't become miserable because of dream. The moment we wake up, our dream is forgotten. Why don't you forget the waking also the same way? Every day, new day, yahoo! Who are you? I'm your daughter. Oh, are you? Maje lo yaar, jeena seekho masti mein. Don't become so serious to survive. And don't seek security so that you can become spiritual. That will never happen. I tried it when I was young. It didn't work. हो गया क्या टाइम नहीं है. द गुरु महाराज विल स्ट्रिप द डिसाइपल ऑफ ऑल द थ्री प्लेन्स ऑफ कॉन्शियसनेस. ऑल हैपनिंग्स विल एंड. there will be no individuality to hang on to. The individuality has also been constantly changing. See, we think individuality, I am an individual. You think you are a continuous. It is true you are continuous, but not as an individual. You are a continuous as the Atma, as the Self, which is your natural state. Then individuality, sometimes you are a father individual, sometimes you are a brother individual, sometimes you are a husband individual. With every thought that appears in our mind, the I also comes up. I is not continuous. Atma is continuous. And you are superimposing that Atma, the continuity of that Atma, on the I. But the rule is, the subject I can appear as subject only when there is an object. So one thought is made up of aham vritti and idam vritti. That shuddha aham, which is our essential nature, which is thought free, it becomes a thought when it comes in association with something, when it becomes identified. And with every thought, this I is coming. And it is happening so fast that there is an illusory continuity of this I accepted by the individual. And that is what who we all are. See? Every day the dreamer wake has a different body, is in a different world, is in a different place, having a different wife, different children. Sometimes he is a sannyasi, sometimes he is a married person, sometimes he is a beggar, sometimes he is a king. You enjoy the dream, you know. When you are in the dream, you take it so real. When you wake up, it was a dream. Same here also. But we have made it. We have become serious. My progeny, my children, my wife, my parents. Your attention is on them. Your attention is not on the pure consciousness. See? So individuality also keeps changing. How? Look at it in this way, another way of putting it. Waking consciousness, dream consciousness, sleep consciousness, again waking consciousness, dream consciousness, waking consciousness. Continuously the consciousness is changing. Dreamer is not the waker, waker is not the sleeper, sleeper is not the dreamer. Isn't it? This is your experience, isn't it? Then how come you are taking yourself to be the continuous one? And yet you are the continuous one, in essence. But you have superimposed it on this I. You have accepted that I is the continuous one. No, Atma is the continuous one. I comes and goes. So here he says, there'll be no individuality to hang on. Once the contemplation on the Atma Tattva or the Guru Tattva or on the Lord, when it reaches its climax, the individuality will be shattered. Or better word is, the individuality will be dissolved. Just like the ice cube gets dissolved in the waters to become the infinite waters, the individuality will dissolve, because in Vaikhari it was addicted to the forms and or to the separation. In Madhyama it was maintaining the separation, but both was at the thought level. In पश्यंती, इट वॉज एट द अनमैनिफेस्ट लेवल एंड एट द परा इट हैज गॉन बैक टू द सोर्स. फोकस अटेंशन ऑन दैट वन हु हैज सपोर्टेड ऑल दीज कंसेप्ट ऑल थ्रू बट हु इज नॉट कंसेप्चुअल. दिस आत्म तत्व इज नॉट अ कंसेप्चुअल. दिस फीलिंग दैट आई एम अ कंटिन्यूअस वन, आई वॉज देर यस्टरडे, आई एम हियर टूडे एंड आई थिंक आई विल बी देर टूमोरो, आई वॉज देर 1 hour अगो, आई एम हियर नाउ, इन द नेक्स्ट मिनिट ऑल्सो आई विल बी देर. दिस कंटिन्यूटी विच इज देर, इट इज नॉट ऑफ द आई, इट इज नॉट ऑफ द इंडिविजुअल. दिस कंटिन्यूटी इज ऑफ द आत्मा विच हैज बीन सुपर इम्पोज्ड ऑन द चेंजिंग आई, the changing individuality, the changing personality, whichever way you put it. See, concepts come and go. I thought is a concept. I have to realize is a concept. The word Aham Brahmasmi at the mind level is a concept. In its essence, what it is indicating is the truth. But when you are thinking about it, it is a concept. So concepts can change. Concepts can change. Once upon a time they took the earth to be flat, today they say it is round. It has changed. Once upon a time they said these medicines are good for this, today they have taken it out of the market. Concepts have changed. In India, in the 60s, 70s, they sprayed DDT all over India. That was the conviction. After 10 years, 15 years of that, they discontinued. Why? It changed. Waking, dream, sleep change every day. But the one unchanging who is, in whose presence these three come and go, he is the non-changing principle, he is the continuous one. And that one I am, that one is our true nature. And this whole journey, this studies, scriptures, everything that we are doing, going through, is only to come to abide, to recognize that we are that. Our obsession with the gross has gone so deep, so entrenched. It is taking so long. Lecture after lecture after lecture to undo everything we have programmed ourselves with. You take a small child and you tell the child all this in the manner that he understands, like this they will grasp it. Why? No data. They are not entrenched with the memories. Therefore the Gurukul system. Therefore the exposure of the children to the masters and the scriptures. To the extent that one focuses attention on that divine presence, to that extent one salutes the Guru. To the extent. So are you, if your attention is on the Guru as an idol, outside, okay, like Eklavya, you will get some abilities. Is your attention on the Guru or the Lord in the mind, you are a bit closer. You don't see yourself as separate to the Guru or the Lord, the Pashyanti, it's healthy. And even that idea that I am not separate to the Guru Maharaj or the divine, because that's still a concept. You have transcended that. That is the goal. So this is the way to salute that Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling us, that through the four speeches, now again, these four speeches, whatever we have talked about before or in other texts, same thing is saying, but in a different manner. In this relationship of Guru Shishya, neither dies. In the death of the Shishya lies the realization of the Guru Tattva. The wave dies only to be absorbed in the ocean. It is a deathless death. This is the surrender and salutations to the Guru Maharaj. How beautiful. In the relationship of Guru Shishya, neither dies. Neither the Guru dies nor the Shishya dies. Why? That one reality alone is expressing as the two. Can the reality die? Can the reality die? Can the essence in the Guru and the essence in the Shishya, can it die? No. In the death of the Shishya lies the realization of the Guru Tattva. Only when this obsession that I am a seeker, only when the obsession that I am separate to the Guru Maharaj, when this obsession as a result of purification is transcended, then alone the Guru Tattva is realized, or this disciple comes to abide. See? The wave dies only to be absorbed in the ocean. So wave came up from the ocean and wave has merged back into the ocean. You call the appearance of the wave as birth and disappearance of the wave or merging of the wave back as death. But you never see that wave is only an appearance. Water has always remained the water. Really speaking, nothing is born and nothing dies. Because water is always the same, whether there is a wave or no wave. Are we seeing it that way about ourselves? Birth happened, death will happen. We are the same, the Guru Tattva is the same, the Self is the same. Or are we so obsessed with this body that we are afraid to die, therefore we want to realize? Question to be pondered upon. Are you doing it out of fear? Because we want survival. We want to be immortal. Now, Ravana also wanted to be immortal. We can never be immortal with the body. In essence, we are immortal. But as a specific body, we can never be immortal. So this we have to realize, this notion, this vision that was told in the previous verse, the need, the readiness, the ability and the resolve. We need to change our vision, that we are not seeking the truth for our survival. It's not that after seeking the truth and realizing the truth, the individuality will continue. No, it cannot continue after that. You are dead anyway, as an individual. See? Then this obsession that we have that I am this body, this also will be dead. Mahatmas are living like that. So we have to recognize that this birth and death, manifestation and unmanifestation is only at the phenomenal level. Nothing happens to the essence. And once the disciple, the shish, so guru and shishya both are phenomena. Both are phenomena. And phenomena cannot express without the substratum. Like Shiva, Parva, Shakti, they cannot express without the substratum. Who is the substratum? Paramashiva. Paramashiva himself is expressing as Guru, Shiva, Parva, Shiva Shakti. That Paramashiva, the transcendental principle, the infinite reality, the Shuddha Chaitanya, itself is expressing as the Guru Shishya. And that whichever has manifested will go out of manifestation sometime. That is the rule of phenomena. That is the rule of phenomena. Recognizing this and never forgetting that you are the continuous one is the true salutations to the Guru Maharaj. Then where is the question of fear after this? Where is the question of survival after this? Our problem is non-acceptance. We know the seasons are changing. We have accepted it. Every year the seasons will come and go. We accept the mirage waters. We know they are imaginary. They will go. Because of it's a phenomena. We understand the sunrise and sunset, every day it will come and go, it's a phenomena. Why don't you accept this body also as a phenomena? Why don't you accept your mind also as a phenomena? Why don't you accept the waking dream and deep sleep and samadhi also as a phenomena? The day you accept it as it is, accept phenomena as phenomena. What is happening at this moment? You have accepted the phenomena as I. So all the challenges and all the troubles are there. Don't accept it as I. Accept it as the phenomena. Accept the self as I. Like this, everything will, all the issues will dissolve. That will be the true salutation. And we are not saying that don't accept, when we say accept the phenomena as phenomena, we understand that this phenomena is none other than the divine, because this phenomena is because of the Shakti, and Shakti is not other than Shiva. That this phenomena is at the Shakti level. Shakti at the individual level is the mind. It is not that the self is becoming something. It is not that the water is becoming waves. Water remains water. The becoming and unbecoming is the phenomena of the wave. Recognize this about ourselves, that we are the continuous one, and the coming of the body and the going away of the body, it's changing throughout your life. The body has changed. Accept it as that. Thoughts have changed. Accept it as that. Waking dream and deep sleep have changed. Accept them as it is. Why you get troubled by them? Because we identify with them, that this is me. This body alone is me. That is the problem. These are the thoughts. This is my nature. This is my character. This is my values with which I live, then suffer. Who is going to help after that? So, if we want to change the vision, that is our goal. And for that, as Jnaneshwar Maharaj says again, I repeat it, first we have to feel the intrinsic need within our bosom that the present approach to life is not helping. It's not helping. It's leading to the same conclusions which I came to 10 years ago. It's still keeping, okay, 10 years ago I was more duty oriented, but today I am more spiritual oriented, but I'm still in the world. I have not transcended the world, which means my approach is going wrong somewhere. And I seem to be doing everything right, but somewhere something is not clicking. So I need to change. And then once the need is there, then it must be supported by the readiness and the ability, and eventually lead to the resolution. And that resolution or the resolve will be losing all attachment to the body, to the idea, to the I, to the personality, to the past, to the future, to the waker, dreamer, sleeper. You will even lose the identity with the seeker. That will also be lost, because that's total dissolution. This pralay that will come about, it will happen in your awareness. That pralay is the unmanifestation. Remember when we studied Shiva Shakti, in that Shiva is ever in contemplation of his own essential nature. Shakti begins, she wants attention because that is her nature. So she starts multiplying, and as she starts multiplying, when it reaches a critical point, Shiva has to open his eyes. When he opens his eyes, he doesn't, because it is his own potential. The Shakti is his own potential. So he doesn't see the Shakti as separate to him. So when he sees, oh wow, Ashcharyavat Pashyati Kaschidena, he is in wonderment. And in that wonderment, he closes his eyes, again the Shakti again becomes unmanifest. Then again it manifests. That is what is happening to us. We become available to the phenomena. We become unavailable to the phenomena. But when we become unavailable to the phenomena, we call it sleep. Because we are living it at a default level. Mahatmas do not sleep. They are ever in and through all the waking, dream, deep sleep, they are ever aware of their essential nature. How to purify in order to come to that final surrender or salutation in which we fall back into ourselves? That will be the topic of our next chapter. But before that, there is something here. Meditation is given and summary is given. We'll look at that in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. See you in the next class.